Hello ladies and gentlemen, Nick here and welcome to my review of Vertigo, which is a 1958 film directed by Alfred Hitchcock. And it's pretty much a thriller mystery in a way. The plot of the film sees a retired detective called John, I believe, or Scotty to his friends. We'll just call him Scotty then. As he is enlisted by an old friend to watch his wife. As he believes she's being possessed by the spirit, I suppose, of a woman who was who died after going mad a century before. However, the wife, after quite a lot of time, sadly commits suicide, and Scotty is left with all the guilt. As for starters, he was supposed to be protecting her. And secondly, they had fallen in love with each other. So Scotty's now all depressed. He's wondering if he's having these dreams. He's wondering if he's having this problem. The reason he couldn't stop her from committing suicide is because he was going to, but he's now got a fear of heights, hence vertigo, which we saw at the start of the film. He developed a fear of heights after getting stuck high up and watching a police colleague fall to his death after trying to help him. So he's unable to prevent the suicide, so he feels that guilt as well as the fact that he loved her, and now he's having all these dreams. But then he sees a woman who looks exactly like her, or almost exactly, and tries to get in a relationship with her and make her look like the wife of his friend. However, it turns out that this is all a conspiracy. I knew it! There's a conspiracy. There's always a conspiracy. And it turns out that this woman was the woman he had fallen in love with, and that they had killed the husband, the man that hired Scotty to follow his wife, had actually killed her and hired this other woman to pretend to be her, and they accidentally fell in love. And then this woman pretending to commit suicide, but instead she ran up the stairs and the husband threw the wife's body off the roof. Strangulation apparently is the official cause of death, and then they snuck back down after Scotty snuck out. As he had a fear of heights, he would not follow all the way to the top. And Scotty eventually realizes this whole plan and works it all out when he sees the necklace around the woman who, before he realizes it's the same woman, and the pretender, so let's say the actress. Her name's Judy, by the way. Yeah, I'll just call her Judy. And she pretended to be Madeline, who's the wife. So he realises that Judy was Madeline when he saw the necklace. And he, in the process, he'd already been trying to make her look like her. The ending, he then drives them to the scene of the crime, and he reveals what he knows as they climb up to the top of the tower, and that's where they have the final confrontation. But Judy does really love him, honestly. She honestly does. And when somebody comes up to the top, she runs off and accidentally dies. Turns out this someone was one of the nuns there, and that's the end of the film. Judy runs off the tower and accidentally dies. So yeah, that's Vertigo. So this is a kind of a mystery film. As beforehand, for most of the film, we're told that this led to believe that there is the spirit or something, or ghost of Carlotta trying to possess Madeline, and something, black her out, make her do things or go places she wouldn't normally go, or at least not knowingly. But it turns out this was all a act for Scotty, including an attempted suicide, which was again just an act. And it's after that that Scotty and Madeline, or Judy pretending to be Madeline at least, start falling in love and start developing the feelings. I have to say it is a pretty slow film in that regard. At least for the first hour and a half, it is quite slow building this all up. The mystery is built up really well, but it doesn't feel like it's going very far to start with. And then later on with the relationship, I was kind of a bit worried with the thing, because lovely neighbor's wife, as John Voight's character in Mission Impossible said, or somewhere along those lines. Because he'd technically be, if he fell in love with her, it would be cheating on the husband. Although that it turns out that he didn't really need to worry about that in the first place. So, okay. And I like how the way of the guilt was presented until he met Judy. Because then afterwards it became a bit more of a forceful, not really an abusive relationship. He was just forcing her to do some stuff, a bit controlling, that's the word, controlling relationship. And because she was also, yeah, the one who played the wife. So extra strength on her for that. So for some reason he's trying to make her look like Madeline more 100% as opposed to already looking like her a little bit. Maybe it's part one of his ways of getting rid of the guilt. Maybe it's one of his ways of working out all the answers. So I guess. And I think the actors all do great jobs with the roles, especially James Stewart in the lead role. And I think I can't remember the actress's name, but they do good jobs. There's also and former lover slash friend, a good friend of Scotty, who's there a few times. She's looking after him to start with, and she's a helpful hand in some points. But later on, she becomes a bit jealous of him and Madeline slash Judy. And then second half of the film, she's not really there that much. Yeah, I mean, she was good for the first half of the film, but afterwards she disappeared for quite a bit. The husband, he's good in the few scenes he did. It was quite a twist to see that it was all a conspiracy. I thought this was going to be more of a psychological story, or maybe the ghost or spirit had started to possess her. But it turned out it was all a trick. It was all an act. So I suppose that makes a lot of sense in a way, and in a more realistic terminology. So yeah, it's questionable storytelling, but it's effective. It's just that it takes a while to get to it. The film is about 2 hours, 5 to 9 minutes. So it does take its time, actually having to go through it all. But it could easily have been a little bit shorter. Maybe 10 minutes of that slowness could have been skipped or sped up. But overall, it's really good. And it looks really nice. All the shots look very good. And the editing is pretty great for the most part. So the visual effects are mostly good. But I can't say they're that perfect. Even for 1958, they look okay. But not amazing. And the music, it's good, it's alright. I don't expect the theme to be something that's going to become something famous like the Psycho's theme. It's good for this film, but don't expect it to become a signature theme like Psycho's one. Overall, Vertigo is a good film, but it's just a very slow-paced film to start with a rushed ending as well. Not so much the reveal of everything, but Judy then running to her death accidentally, and Scotty and the nun looking over the death, and the nun then ringing the bell. It's a bit fast, it's a bit quick, it's just over like that in a way. As soon as Judy's fallen to her death, more or less as soon as that's happened, end. Yeah. Another week ending. It's not as bad as The Birds, where we don't get closure. This one, we've got the answers we've been looking for, that, and now that's it. But something a little bit, I mean, it could have been slowed down just a little bit, just make it last a few more seconds. But nope, that's it. Bye-bye. End of film. Consider we've had all that build-up, and it's just over really quickly. Well, the ending is, not the film. So there you go, Vertigo. Can't say it's a perfect film. I think it's a very good film, but it's not terribly that amazing. It's good, but it's not amazing. So I'm going to give Vertigo a 8 out of 10. So, yeah. Not perfect, but still pretty great. It's not one of the... I've seen 5 Hitchcock films now. Rear Endo, Psycho, Darwin for Murder, The Birds, and this, in that order. And I have to say, this is weaker one, in terms of storytelling anyway. In terms of execution, it's around... it's probably the same level. I would put it 4th above The Birds, which we're gonna watch later on in the uni semester. So we'll see how a second view of that turns out. But I wouldn't be surprised if that was still 5th. I would put Die End for Murder at 3rd. I would put Rear Window at 2nd. I thought that was a really great film. And Psycho, of course, is 1. Psycho is brilliant. With that one's ending, that one, I think. I like that they had a shot of the car being pulled out of the lake at the end, but it just lasted too quickly. It was that one was also a quick final shot. Wish they drawn that one out a little bit more, just a couple more seconds. Otherwise, they should have just ended on Norman Bates. But anyway, I think the best ending from these 5 films is probably from Rear Window. It's a nice wrap-up. But anyway, so that's Vertigo. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. The next film we'll be looking at will be Cleo from 9 to 7 in class. Let me just check it. So I'm thinking it's either 5 to 7 or 5 to 9. So that's the next one in our film introduction to film theory class. The next, here we go. Yeah, Cleo from 9 to 7, from 5 to 7, followed by The Dark Knight, Hedwig and the Angry Inch, and The Birds. I might do a re-review of The Birds afterwards. We'll see, and like I said, I also do Batman Begins and The Dark Knight Rises before and after The Dark Knight. Coming up next on from films will be the next James Bond film, On Her Majesty's Secret Service. And this film is also kind of a slow build up to the plot, but it does it more effectively, and the outcome is a bit more the outcome is just as if not more enjoyable when the ending isn't over like that. It actually takes its time. So yeah, so next time on Her Majesty's Secret Service. And also next Doctor Who story will be Fury from the Deep. I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye. Don't forget to click below to subscribe to the official Nicholas Payne Retro YouTube channel.
That's what it is.
However, the woman, excuse me. Um...